Welcome to the Capital Discussions Roundtable. I'm Tom Nonnemaker with Jim Riggio and our guest Don Kaufman from TheoTrade. Before we get started, a quick disclaimer, the Capital Discussions is not a broker-dealer or an investment advisor. This presentation is for educational purposes only. We don't know your situation and have no way of knowing what level of risk is appropriate for you. We're not making any specific trade recommendations. The risk of loss in trading options can be substantial, so please be aware of all your risks prior to placing any trades. Hypothetical computer simulated trades are believed to be accurately represented. However, actual profit or loss may vary due to market factors such as liquidity, slippage, and commissions. And once again, this is for educational purposes only. So with that out of the way, Don, welcome. I'll transfer the presenter role over to you.
All right. Thank you very much for having me.
Yeah, you're welcome. You should be able to share your screen now.
All right. Let's see if I can't figure this out. I have a lot of monitors on here. All right. Wait, there's hope for me. See if this works.
See if we got the right one.
You should see Thinkorswim. Yep.
I do. Perfect.
All right. So I'm just going to drag this bar off here, and again, we should be good to go. So let me open up a chat box over here so I can make sure that I can read everybody's comments. And yeah, feel free to chat in from time to time, guys, if you do have questions, comments, or otherwise. So I'm not too familiar with, you know, WebEx here. So, you know, I'm going to run you guys through a presentation. I have a presentation that I'm doing tonight. I'm actually going to run you guys through it, and hopefully you'll appreciate some of the things I am going to go through. This presentation, again, for tonight, it's for TheoTrade, so it's called The Next Big Short, and it's coming into a class that we're going to be doing here in the very near future. But nevertheless, let me kind of take you through it, because I put quite a bit of time into this one. So here's our risk disclosure. You know, you just had a risk disclosure, Tom, but I'll throw mine up here. I'm not a financial broker or dealer. I was one for the previous 15 years with obviously Thinkorswim, TD Ameritrade, but no longer. Here's a little bit about me. Again, my name is Don Kaufman, co-founder of TheoTrade. We actually got some interesting financiers and so forth at TheoTrade. A couple people that were involved early on at Thinkorswim helped finance and build TheoTrade in the last year. So we're obviously a newer company. I've had an 18-year trading career. If you are using the Thinkorswim trading application, I am fairly familiar with it. Was there when they pretty much had build number one kind of surface out there. So with that, again, what I'm going to take you into is really a strategy for an upcoming class that I'm going to be doing. And again, I just want to, because I, you know, Tom and Jim told me that this is a little bit more of an experienced group. So I'm going to run a couple of different ideas, by you guys and see if you like the strategy that I'm going to present on here, because one way or the other, the strategy is coming out. So something I always start with is risk and success. How you handle your risk is directly correlated to your success in the markets. Too much risk and you panic, close positions continually at the worst possible time. And I often start with that on really any presentation that I do, that I'm not a big market technician. And I like people to know that. So do I have charts up? Sure. Knock yourself out, if you want technical indicators and so forth. One of the things I try to do at TheoTrade is try to provide you every technical indicator you could ever want, need. So if you are on Thinkorswim and you see any of the technical indicators that I might use, like, these tick indicators, or I just did a presentation last week, on this like RSI, Legree. It's kind of a funky version of an RSI. If you're into indicators, come to our site. We give them to you for free. Like, we don't charge for indicators. I don't believe that anybody, should charge for indicators when Thinkorswim is trying to give them away for free. But I figured I'd throw that out there right up front. I'm much more, though, a quantitative trader, which means for the most part that I'm about strategy. I'm about tactic. I put directional bias to the back of the line. I mean, if there's three things that I'll look at in trades, I look at strategy and logic. Number two would be allocation. You overallocate, you're gonna puke. And number three, of course, on that list would be directional bias. Those are the three things that I always consider when entering into any position, whether it's a longer duration position, whether it's a short-term position. I'm always looking at those three aspects, because it doesn't matter how good your directional bias is. If you've got the wrong strategy, okay? The wrong logic, the wrong allocation, you're dead. And you have to realize that at some point in your, you know, progression in the markets, that the rest of the entire retail world is talking about direction. And you go to any major derivatives firm in the planet, and I've been to them all, and I've got buddies that work at all the derivatives firms. They're not talking about like, oh, what do you think that this stock is going to do? What do you think Apple is going to do with the announcement? They don't care. They got their strategy, their logic, and that works over time. So this, not so much money, but, you know, this is not going to be so much about trying to make money with strategy and logic. This is about getting ready. It's coming, okay? We're going to embark on what's likely to be one of the most pivotal periods in the market's history. Again, prediction of this risk, I feel, is relatively easy. Timing in the onset of the risk, though, is completely impossible. Okay, so a quick review of the volatility right now, or as I say, the lack thereof. So just a quick review of volatility for those of you who are a little maybe newer to this. Have you ever spent time looking at the volatility in the markets and compared it with what you kind of believe the risk to be? So we've hit this, like, when I say there's like a this interesting and pivotal time in the marketplace, a lot of it has to do with volatility. First, what's the volatility, okay, and what does it measure? And I've got my little indicator on over here. This thing will drive me insane, so bear with me. You know, what is volatility? What does it measure? Volatility most notably measures risk in the marketplace. And the volatility that we're talking about is not historical volatility or what we call realized volatility, okay? We're talking about volatility being risk, which is implied volatility. So if you think about option markets, step away from this is a call, this is a put, this is a twisted strategy or whatever it is. Step away from all that. In the end, option markets can be thought of as just putting a price tag on risk. I mean, pricing, okay, in markets is determined by a market participants. I know everybody's like, it's the volatility, it's this, it's the Black-Scholes equation. You know, once upon a time, I was a little bit more of like an options geek where I would get into different pricing models and so forth. But in the end, when you think about volatility being equivalent to risk, if everybody goes out and they buy puts in the SPX, the volatility goes up, right? So ultimately, options pricing comes down to supply and demand. Now, with that, this is just a little bit about implied vol. Again, as a reminder to you that when you're trading in markets, sometimes, you know, primary pieces of logic get thrown by the wayside. We kind of forget, you know, in the end, what implied volatility really denotes. So if you have a vol of 20% on this $100 stock, kind of means that, you know, standard deviation, the stock can move roughly from 80 to about 120. Okay. Now, what I'm doing in this particular circumstance here is I'm taking an implied volatility. An implied volatility, it's standardized, being it's always annualized. So for the most part, what the implied volatility denotes here of like 20% kind of means this thing can move up 20 bucks or down 20 bucks. But that's good for like what? That's 1 year. And it'll stay in this range approximately 68.3% of the time. Now, most of you guys have heard that. And what I just ran you through, this is the cliff note version of what expected move is. But nobody really cares, like, oh, what's volatility going to do, you know, for the next year? We all want to know what risk is right here, right now, like today. So for the most part, you can take a standardized volatility, which is annualized, and you can divide it by a week, a month, a day, and you can actually come up with what markets are anticipating movement to be today. And if you have, again, no idea what I'm talking about, if you go onto the Thinkorswim platform, you know, one of these, I would say, fairly marquee features on Thinkorswim. And if you don't have Thinkorswim, don't worry about it because I'll show you how to do it without this. But one of what I would consider a marquee feature on the trading application happens to be the expected move. Okay. And if you're not looking at this every day, I think you're doing yourself a huge disservice. The expected move today, this is an option that expires today. Why am I looking at it? Am I interested in buying a couple of these? Maybe, but that's neither here nor there. Okay. I need to get a feel for what risk is today, right here, right now. All right. Even if I'm going to trade a month into the future, what's the market anticipating today? And the answer is quite simple. It's a 6% volatility. I don't know if you guys look back historically. 6% volatility, That is like record-breaking low. I mean, that's like the VIX is 6 for today. That's what it's saying. This is an option that expires literally today. That's what's so cool now about the SPX. There's a Monday expiration, a Wednesday expiration, and a Friday expiration. This week is insane. They moved the Monday expiration because of Labor Day to Tuesday. So there's a Tuesday, a Wednesday, and a Friday expiration. You do realize that this gives you a detailed pulse on the marketplace. The S&P isn't expecting more than a $5 move up or down. And if you don't believe the expected move, well, what do you believe? Look at the straddle. If you look at the at-the-money straddle in here, okay, it's trading for under $5. And to me, it's one of the efficiencies of the market that has never really been looked at before. You know, you got to realize these options that expire, okay, throughout the course of the week, these are brand new. But what we have noticed, and so we've got a quantitative team that we work with, we've actually noticed the expected moves have been spot on in markets, like absolutely unequivocally spot on. If it says it's going to move like $5, we've been moving to the edge of that range out there. And that's, to me, again,
very unnoticed, if you will, in the marketplace. So if you're not looking, again, at stuff like SPX on a day-to-day basis, just to get a feel for what the markets are expecting, again, I think you do yourself a pretty big disservice. And that's one of the reasons I wanted to recap a little bit about volatility today, because, you know, you could be trading Apple, which has an announcement today. But realize that even Apple's movement will be relatively constrained because the SPX is likely to stay in a $5 window. Again, looking at the rest of the day, you got, 4 or 5 hours left in the trading day with a $5 expected move. It's going to be it's going to be riveting, if you will. So, all right, Jim, do you have a question? Sorry, I heard
that. No, I was just laughing. Okay, that's all.
If you looked at the VIX and saw it like, you know, being 6%, you never thought that possible.
And, at zero, it's the expiration line. A lot of people don't realize that, right?
Yeah.
It's like, it's dead. I mean, it really is. It's dead. I ended up saying to somebody the other day, I said, if boring was an Olympic sport, watching paint dry would win the silver medal compared to this market, which wouldn't the gold.
It's been that brutal. So you're looking at this thing on a day-to-day basis, and I've got some theories of why we're trapped in this range. Come to that maybe a little bit later over here. But in a quick recap of volatility and the 68%, there's what we call no fear or loathing on Wall Street, right? The degree of complacency in markets, considering the myriad of tail risks on the horizon, it's totally remarkable. Okay, and we're going to come to some of the issues. But before I go any further, there is one thing I want to display, because so many people are like VIX-centric. To me, the VIX is, it's kind of gone by the wayside, right? Like I don't look at it nearly as much as I did, you know, 10, 15 years ago. But the one thing that I am looking at right now is when you look down at stuff like Google, okay, just bear with me for a second. We look at Google and forget about price action. I know Google is just off its all-time highs, but look at the risk, okay? And what's cool about implied volatility is it's standardized. 15% risk in Google can compare to any other product on this watch list, right? So you take a look at Google and you're like, okay, so 15% risk. Yeah, okay, Don, it's low. Compare it to a stock like Walmart. Walmart actually has higher implied volatility. You know how screwed up the system is? When you have Walmart, okay, the higher implied volatility, it's, by the way, Walmart's through its earnings. It doesn't have any earnings coming up, okay? You look at stocks like a Target. Retailers are carrying substantially heavier implied volatility than one of the pinnacle tech stocks in the industry. You know something is seriously wrong in marketplace, okay? And that's, again, brick and mortar stores having, historically speaking, the lowest implied volatilities, okay, out there. There is big problems ahead, and that's one of the things we're going to start to look at over here is, again, people look at the VIX, but the VIX isn't telling the whole story of how screwed up the implied vols are, all right? Now, the issues. Yes, we've got some issues. Broader markets. Here's some of the looming risks. Obviously, the FOMC and central bankers' interest rate policy. The central banks buying corporate debt and ETFs. I'm actually specifically talking about here, number one, what they're doing over the ECB and Mario Draghi, which they're buying corporate debt, which ultimately allows companies to no longer trade
at with price discovery. What that basically means is you go out there and you give a company corporate debt with almost no interest rate associated. They're going to go out there and do how many debt offerings? They don't care. Just keep doing debt offerings. They could be in billions and billions of dollars of debt, and they're going to utilize the money to do stock buybacks and so forth. Nothing matters in terms of valuation at this point. I know that that sounds kind of crazy, but forget about valuation. Japan, they're buying their own ETFs. Okay, is that off the table here in the U.S.? Absolutely not. Some of the looming risks, obviously, the presidential race, followed by the change of administration. I only threw that one in there because even Mark Cuban stepped up the other day and said, if Trump wins, it's all over. He said the market's going to crash and burn, which I kind of got a kick out of a little bit. If you guys haven't followed the history of Mark Cuban, he's been wrong considerably more. He's almost like almost as bad as Dennis Gartman, but not quite. Dennis Gartman kind of takes the cake on that one. There's $11 trillion in negatively yielding debt. Right, Chinese debt is 270% of GDP. I pick on China a little bit. The banking system grew 1,000%. They right now have under 2% of non-performing loans, like what they call NPLs. They're saying they have 2% non-performing loans. We all know it's somewhere closer to 6 to 8%, which basically means at those levels your economy typically caves, but they're actually hiding it using ultimately a shadow banking system over there. So just throwing some of the looming risks. There's 1.3 trillion student loan debt. This one actually is on the wayside. It's actually easy to control. The Brexit, there's currency devaluations. I also threw WikiLeaks in there because we're all going to enjoy that one at the end of October in some way, shape, or form. This is actually an outside that can completely change the entire presidential race. But these are not looming risks. They're all current events. So everything that's going on this screen right here is one of the current events. And yet, you focus back to the markets for a second, and you realize even duration volatility is inherently low. And if I talk about duration volatility, you can look at the VIX futures. Even the VIX futures, 200 days out, are still sitting at 20%, which is below their historical average, if you've, again, ever looked at VIX futures. So those are all the different looming risks over there. This is actually what I call suppression of risk. The Fed, the central bankers, are obviously suppressing risk. So central banks produce volatility suppression. So the whole key of this is that the volatility is being suppressed. It's not actually as low as you might think. Ultimately, what it comes down to is thanks to the central bankers, the banks, proprietary trading firms, hedge funds, anywhere in the world can borrow capital with near zero interest. But it even gets crazier than that. If you look at negative interest rate, okay, the banking and hedge funds have actually figured out a carry trade now that gets them money and they get paid for it. So they can borrow capital and literally get paid for it in a swap trade. The financial systems are just bursting with either cheap or free money. In many circumstances, again, negative interest rate policy is forcing lending, okay, and this is all by design. So trillions of capital now are seeking returns. The global financial systems are obviously flush with free money. It's causing asset managers and traders to seek returns anywhere. They, again, the glut of capital, smashing volatility, and causing much more efficiency on a day-to-day basis. If you look at something as easy as bid-offer spreads, you've never seen them tighter than they are right now. Every market participant, they're throwing caution to the wind. And the word out there on the street is that nobody cares. They're just, they have to produce returns at literally any cost. And that's what's ultimately, again, driving a huge amount. So markets are irrational on some of the free money. So again, everything is global capital pouring into specifically the U.S. markets, and it's suppressing not only volatility, but it's also suppressing price discovery, which basically means when I say suppressing price discovery, if you look at products here, on a longer time frame, forget about intraday, forget about, you know, a month from now. On a broader time frame, you forget about charts and technicals. Fundamentals are meaningless. Volatility readings are totally dead. And all the above over here is true. Again, look at any given product on your screen. Look at something as simple as, hey, wow, the S&Ps are actually moving right now. So look at something as simple as fundamentals. Forget about technicals, because I am most assuredly an anti-chartite. You know, I grew up in an anti-chart family. It's not my fault. I was raised this way. But if you look at any fundamentals of marketplace out there, you can't suggest to me in an earnings recession that stock valuation makes sense. You know, look no further than maybe a stock like, I don't know, like Home Depot, which actually hasn't had much upside recently. But you start to open up a broader chart, that makes perfect sense. You start to look at stuff like Momo, Philip Morris, Altria Group. Now, again, I have a 10-year chart up here, but let's knock this thing down to like a 3-year daily. That makes perfect sense. They have actually been in an earnings recession for quite some time, okay? Look at any heavy dividend-paying stock out here and realize how screwed up the world has become. Verizon, what did they reinvent the entire phone industry since the beginning of the year? Because this is a stock that if you do look on a broader time frame, hasn't done anything and shouldn't do anything for the better part of a decade, okay? Capital is just flowing at this point for no reason other than they have to seek yield, okay? And you got to throw caution to the wind. And why do I say that? You know, there's some smart people out there, right? Why do you throw caution to the wind? Why do they just say, oh, screw it, I don't care, let's just throw money into the market? And it comes down to something very, very simple, okay? If you're a mutual fund manager, okay, a hedge fund, and most often if you're managing capital for somebody else, it's in either your prospectus or your guidelines, depending upon how you're structured, that you have to work 90 to 95% of your capital. Now think about that for a second, okay? They have to use their capital in most cases. So again, this is kind of one of our takes here on kind of what we call irrational free money. You have to look at this, though, is suppression of risk. It just presents possibly one of the largest opportunities in recent history. I mean, that's one of the things that you just have to start to recognize. The opportunity is there. This is not like a bad thing. Risk is good. All of the issues, okay, all right, all boil down to what they are is opportunity. You got to have a strategy where you're not going to substantiate inordinate risks, yet you want to position yourself for the onslaught of volatility. Now, this is not easily done, okay? I'm going to put it bluntly. You want to buy the crap out of volatility. Okay, we want to buy volatility as we believe the future market risks are formidable. Even if you did not believe the risks are forthcoming, you still need to accept the relative dangers and mitigate exposure accordingly. The risks are clear. We see the opportunity. Yet how do you go about buying volatility? And this is where everybody's going to get caught up like, oh, yeah, I want to buy volatility. I want to buy volatility. I've spent months trying to figure this out, okay? You can buy volatility-based ETF products. It's common knowledge. You can buy volatility products in today's marketplace. However, volatility-based products, they're riddled with failure. Okay? Look at volatility exchange-traded funds, the ETFs. Two prominent volatility ETFs, the VXX and the UVXY. This is the VXX over the past 6 months. It's lost 63% of its value. Look at it over the life of the product. It's lost over 99% of its value. The UVXY, this thing's pretty much out of business. They've had to reverse split it multiple times in just the last couple of months. Just in the last 6 months, it's lost 89% plus of its value. That's a six-month chart. It's 186 all the way down to 17, okay? These products are flushing capital right down a toilet. You buy them, okay? You hold them even for a day. The contango in the vol futures, okay, which is the differential between front and back vol futures, the contango is so huge that there's no chance you can even make money in the product. Maybe one day, like on August 24th, you would have been all right. But for the most part, it's brutal out there, okay? You can't succeed by buying volatility outright. You need to be smarter than the competition. Now, that statement over there, you don't have to be a genius out there. You just got to be smarter than maybe some of the other retail clientele. And this is where I started digging, positioning your portfolio for a big move. Let's get kind of down and dirty with it. How do you position yourself most effectively for the possibility of an extreme move without exposing yourself to drastic risks? You know, don't get cute, because this is pretty serious. You know, there's going to be millions and millions of dollars in the next couple of months up for grabs. So what we've actually built is what we call a risk twist spread. So we're going to employ a ratio type option spread. Now, many of you are familiar with like what's called a ratio back spread. Just out of curiosity, everybody familiar with this? Okay. Anybody familiar with like a ratio back spread over there?
So there's some issues, though, with the ratio back spread that I can't get over. Yeah, everybody is. Okay. Yeah, I got one yes. Wow. All right. There's this thing called the chat box. You can put it in there. So the ratio back spread. So I twisted it a little bit. I had to. And the reason I call it a risk twist spread, and listen, there's nothing unique about the markets. All I'm doing is taking put options in a specific ratio to overcome skew. But the idea, it's really easy. We want to achieve maximum reward for minimal upfront cost. Okay? So the risk twist screams, limit your exposure and maximize your potential. And what it really breaks down to is this is just a quick risk graph, and I can show you a number of these spreads, but the risk graph is pretty simple, and I'll be pretty forthright with it. Here's where we currently are. It has unlimited profit potential if we crash and burn, but this strategy is also going to have a tremendous sensitivity to changes in vol. Okay. The other key point is I'm only going to have about a 90-cent debit up front in this little monkey. And again, if you take a look at this on the spiders, you know, like, oh, you need the spiders all the way down. This is spiders. You need the spiders all the way down in the neighborhood of what? Okay. You know, 170 to make it worthwhile. It's actually not true. Even if the spiders got down to the 200 level, this thing starts to become wildly profitable, especially if, again, volatility spikes. And that's what you expect with a market that sold off from, let's say, 218 down to 200. Vol might get pumped in by an amount of about 10%. As volatility spikes, okay, so goes the risk curve. I mean, you'll actually take off to the upside over here. So this is exactly what I'm going to be displaying. I'll kind of take you through it. Question?
Don, do you have the day step up there? Do you also have a graph of the vol step that shows us what would have?
Nope, I'm going to do that, though. I'll take you guys through it live here in a couple of minutes. I'm running through the whole presentation quickly. And then I'm actually going to take you into the market, and I'll show you how to vol step it, how to tweak it a little bit. So, yeah, I day step this one just to show you how the trade might mature over X number of days all the way out to, you know, early October. But, hey, I put this presentation together for people that didn't even know what an option was. So here's some characteristics, though, of the risk twist spread. And this is actually one of the little monkeys right down below here. And by that, I mean, this is the ratio. It's the debit. Notice that it is out in the DEX expiration. So there's a lot of factors to this trade that you have to align perfectly to make this little monkey work. It's a 90-cent debit on the trade. So if you do one contract, this is one, I'll call it one unit because it's a 1 by 3 by 1. The reason of the funky ratio, you needed the ratio to overcome some of the skew because the skew in the major index products, it sucks right now. It makes it almost impossible to trade. So this particular ratio has, it doesn't totally overcome the skew, not even close, but it offsets some of the skew. It lessens the pain, if you will, by using the ratio. And there is, it's about $1,000 margin per unit that's being tied up in here, and I'll show you that. But here's a couple of the characteristics of the spread. Of course, it increases in value when exposed to heavy volatility. Increases in value when the markets sell off drastically. Significant profit potential with a big downside move. Loses minimal capital if we rally. So if you rally, your 90 cents is gone. Okay. Loses minimal capital if the markets drift. It's got no risk if we just drift in and around. Need only be placed a few times a year. So if actually substantiated, you're only going to have to probably place this 3 to 4 times a year. It's perfect spread to reduce risk of a stock portfolio. You know, people go out there, they buy puts. The skew is impossible to buy puts. So you can use some risk twist spreads. If we get another August 24th of 2015, it'll drastically reduce risk of a stock portfolio. It's also an excellent tool for seeking large returns in a big market event. So if we crash and burn, you're going to make a couple grand out of it. And that's, in effect, what I was trying to create with this. And it's such a simple idea. But execution of this is critically, critically important. So as I go through here, building the risk ticks, you know, don't let the options intimidate you. The spread below is for a 90-cent debit. The spread is what I kind of call the massive chainsaw of the marketplace. Used correctly, you know, it's going to scream returns. It can create returns incorrectly. You're probably going to lop off a couple of fingers. And it has to do with how the spread will mature through time. And again, I'm going to take you through the actual trade here in the live market. So what I call fear not the risk twist spread. You know, if you don't know options, you have limited experience in placing trades, don't worry about it. Okay. It's, you know, we can show you how and when to place the trade. It's a matter of a few hours. And there is a class that I'm going to do that's coming up on this. So no real pitch to you guys. Again, you know the markets and so forth. So what we actually do that really kind of differentiates, listen, here's the strategy. I don't care. Copy it. Do it. But what we do is we create recipes for each and every strategy out there. You know, as I say, you don't bake a cake without a recipe. So why trade without one? And it's literally what we do at TheoTrade is every strategy, you know, you can be sought after. You can place it. You know, you can go online, figure out what an iron condor is in the next 10 minutes here on Google. It's successfully trading. It is a very different idea. So it's about what strikes, when to enter it, when to exit it, you know, what ETF candidate. Obviously, I did it in the spiders. I'm sure people are already playing with their, you know, analyze tab on Thinkorswim and playing with this in the SPX. I have to tell you, I put the trade together specifically in the spiders because one unit of that trade, one little unit of the trade is still a monster. And if it has $1,000, okay, of margin exposure, and it's a 1x3x1 and can still make a huge amount of capital with a one lot out there. And that's, it's important. So if you're looking towards, you know, the SPX, it's not wrong, but you're going to be talking about some heavy margin, okay, in a much larger, substantial downside trade. I mean, like one unit in the SPX in a big down environment will make $30,000-$40,000. So I can even show that a little bit. So what option prices do you buy? What do you sell? And this is what we actually do during our classes. And again, I'm being, you know, pretty blunt with walking you through this over here. Sorry, I'm like this. Sorry about that. I'm talking to some of the other guys in the chat room, in my other chat room here from TheoTrade right now. So every what if, though, is something that we try to answer. Can you fix it? You know, what if the stock rallies? What if we sell off big? Obviously, if we sell off big, you're going to kill it with this particular strategy. And that's ultimately what we do in the classes is answer all the what ifs. So with that, I'm actually going to take you now over into the market, okay, and show you what it actually does, what it can do, all right, kind of the secrets in the sauce over here. The class, just so you guys know, it's coming up. And this particular class is coming up September 17th. Should be 3 or 4 hours, okay? We're also going to give people the basics and beyond, the vertical spread. The class is $197. But there's more. For you guys, I know we gave a link to Tom and Jim. It's theotrade.com/special. All I ask is please do not share that link with anybody else. If you go to theotrade.com/special, and again, I'm going to go over to the Thinkorswim platform here momentarily, and I'm going to show you the actual strategy. If you go to this, nobody else has this link. It's a link that we set up for groups and so forth. If you want to go to the class, it's $99. If you sign up for 4 months, it's $299. If you sign up for an entire year, it's only $800 for the entire year, which, by the way, $800 for a whole year, it gives you access to every single class we're going to do. We do at least one class a month, but right now we have Doc Severson working for us. We've actually got Jeff Bierman. A lot of people don't know that Jeff Bierman just joined the crew. So Bierman worked with me at Thinkorswim for 7 years. So Bierman, who was on my team, he's on my team again. So I just hired him. We have Doc Severson, who's been an options geek for many, many years. We have a Tony Rago, who's our futures expert. We actually have Slim Miller now, Steve Miller. You guys know Steve Miller, maybe. Who else do we have on here? I mean, and we have Heisenberg, which is the group of collective writers. I'll tell you guys some fun stuff about him maybe later on over here. But basically, for $800 for the whole year, it gives you access to every single class that we've ever done. I mean, we don't sell indicators. We give them to you. We don't sell classes. We give them to you. You just pay the one fee, and you're in for everything. And it's been a wildly successful model. So it's been great. And that's why, you know, hey, for groups and so forth, we'll do like a special you know, we don't, you know, get much out of it. And by the way, most of how TheoTrade operates, TD Ameritrade, Thinkorswim, is a very large supporter. That's why we don't charge much for the stuff, because we've been sending a lot of clients, of course, to Thinkorswim and TD Ameritrade. And as such, they cover most of your costs out there. It's not completely free. Nevertheless, it works extremely well for us. So let me go in to the marketplace. And so I've got a lot of inventory on right now. This is my account. It's not a paper trading account. Okay, I've got a TheoTrade account. I've got my own, you know, personal positions behind that. But these are all live trades in here. I'm short. I'm a 6,000 spider deltas right now in overall markets. Neither here nor there. My theta absolutely sucks right now. It's all right. You know, I'll get them again. So clearly I'm short. This risk to a spread, I've got one on the spiders. And, you know, I've placed a number of them, okay, over the last couple of months. It's just not a strategy that I ever was really, I guess, nothing really sparked me to want to teach kind of a funky strategy that I might use. And the reason being is it's a little complicated for people that are brand new to the market. So I'm out in DEES, okay? And I'll go to the Analyze tab, and I'll actually show you the trade kind of unfold in the Analyze tab here. So this is a 1x3x1. P&L on a day-to-day basis is going to be negligible. You're not going to see this trade really moving, okay? What you're looking at on this Analyze tab right now is the price slice is live. It's 218.62. It's moving with the market. The strategy is set up right now with what we call an expiration plus one. That means right now and pretty much at expiration. So if you carry this trade to expiration, okay? By the way, yes, Slim joined us. Slimmy! Slimmy, yeah, Slimmy used to be on Tasty Trade. So, you know, we're here. I'll poke fun at Tom Sosnoff for just a second. Tom hates charts, okay? I'm not a big chart fan either, but at least I have come to accept that retail clients actually look at charts. So I'm the option geek. I just surrounded myself with a couple of market technicians. I thought, what better time to do it, right? I got Slim, I got Jeff Bierman. I've got, you know, Doc Severson, who's like a fractal energy geek. Why not surround yourself with a bunch of market technicians? And then I brought in like a crazed futures trader that nobody knew except me. And I just shoved the microphone in front of his face, and it worked. It's pretty good. So let me actually show you a couple things on this strategy. Number one, this is expiration plus one, okay? So it ultimately means here's the profit and loss graph right now, and I want to kind of enunciate this. This is the P&L graph right now. Obviously, it bends pretty hard, even with one unit. Here's the risk if you held it to expiration, right? One of the pieces of criteria that we'll go through is if you hold this thing towards expiration, you're out of your mind. There's no reason to hold it too deep. The reason I'm using December is because December options have a nice sensitivity to vol, right? The longer duration option, they're more sensitive to changes in implied volatility. So that's going to be incredibly important. Now, with that, if you take a look at the trade and instead of using expiration plus one, you do what's called day stepping it. Day stepping allows you to see how the trade matures through time. And all I'm doing is showing you, and I'm going to zoom in very tightly here, I'm showing you how this trade is likely to change all the way out, for instance, to November 14th. Now, does this assume limited change in skew of volatility? For those of you that are volatility geeks, well, if you're a volatility geek, respect the fact that I use the 202, 204, and 214. The skew can shift all at once. It doesn't matter. I'm spread enough across the spectrum that it'll actually sustain almost the exact same risk graph. You got to get smarter than the market. Okay, the market's pretty easy. You know what skew looks like. You've seen it 1,000 times. Don't get screwed by it by actually spreading inventory to three different areas of the skew. So the skew can shift monstrously on me. The skew will actually likely help me, okay, in the event that the market tanks. And what's going to help me? I know these 204 puts are going to come close to possibly being at the money or in the money. And frankly, once the 204 puts do go deep in the money, the skew is not really going to be impactful in any regard. It's going to go intrinsic. So the skew is going to have really limited impact on here. What will have a very positive impact, though, is overall changes in implied vol. Okay, so the skew is less, you know, worrisome. The overall impact of implied volatility, though, can change the strategy pretty drastically. And here, I'll show you this in effect. So here's the risk graph. Let's just take the vol and pump it up a little bit, okay? All I'm doing is just clicking on volatility and saying, what if vol goes up 2%? You can already see changes in here, but forget 2%. Let's go just for the full, 10-point move. So this is like the VIX moving up 10 full points. The VIX is at, 12, 13. Where is it these days? I don't even look at the thing anymore. 12, 13, there you go. It goes up to 22, and the strategy expands. Now, again, you're going to have some shift in the vol skew and so forth. You might not make the full 10 points, but that's all, again, it's relative. It's what's expected.
Don, why don't you show the vol steps? That's what I'm
going
to. Okay.
I'm going that direction just a second. So, assuming the market didn't even move, you get a 10-point bump in vol, and you'd see like a 20% increase, which is nothing. Okay. The strategy isn't so much designed for like a vol pump as it is if the market just tanks. It also has an attribute of sensitivity to volatility. So let me come back down here and reset all the parameters in there. What Jim is actually talking about is this is total geek fest over here. This is basically what vol stepping is. It's looking at the volatility, okay, at incremental steps. And I don't think a 5% vol step is reasonable. I usually use like a 2% vol step. And what that basically does, 5% is pretty big, but it looks at the vol at about, like where it is in the spiders, 11%, 13%, 15%, 17%, 20%. And then, of course, you can drag your little mousey on the screen and see what some of the differential would be. And if 2% isn't enough, sure, you can jump it to a 5% differential. That takes you all the way out to a 30 volatility. I mean, that's pretty intense. So the market tanks, you get a big bang in volatility, and all of a sudden, one unit of this little trade, produces $1,500 or $2,000 profitability. So here's a feature that I do use all the time. I add slices, okay? I'm a total, forget about the risk graph. The slices tell you a lot more, okay? What the slices do, I put them in percentage terms, and I say, what if we sold off by 5%? What if we sold off by 8%? What if we sold off by 10%? And lo and behold, what if we sold off by, okay, a full 15%? So you look at the downside capabilities of it. Now, okay, again, forget about the risk graph for a second. You sell off by 10%, you're like, really? You only made like, what, 33% on this thing? Okay, granted, number one, you only had $90 at risk. So profitability should be around $500. And by the way, I'm taking off about $40 off here just to be reasonable because the vol skew is going to impact it to a degree. But note, with a 10% sell-off in the market, I haven't changed the volatility. What if the volatility really did go up 10 points? Now watch this as I hit enter. Okay, it's pretty much going to double the P&L. Now if you go down 15%, the options are going to go into intrinsic value for the most part. You're not going to get much of an impact from volatility. But that's fine, too. A 15% decline in markets, you're looking at about $1,600 profitability for one unit. And I want to be reasonable. This is a strategy that's on right now. That's one unit. And the reason I put on one unit is just to show you a one lot can do some serious damage if you've got the right strategy, the right ratio, okay, and the right strike prices selected. And that's really the whole impact of this strategy. Use it 3-4 times a year. If nothing happens in the market, sweet. You didn't lose anything. $90. Okay. If the market absolutely tanks, hey, great. Now, one last thing you got to worry about. You can get your head handed to you if we trade down to what? Right here. It's called the Valley of Death. The Valley of Death exists in any ratio type spread. This is easily circumnavigated. You just exit the thing well before expiration. That's not going to cost you anything. Right? You already paid $90 for the strategy, but you just buy it back well before expiration. And the reality is you don't want to keep it on anywhere near expiration. Why? Because options lose their sensitivity to vega the further you go out in time. So hence we'll be pulling the strategy off and rolling it out to March, okay, at a very specific time frame. And that's some of the criteria that we kind of cover in the classes. So I will say this, it took me a really long time to come up with the right ratio. That's the whole key to it, is the ratio and the time frames of it that we're actually, for the most part, if you look at the implied vol and the skew in here, one of the things that really bothered me about a regular ratio back spread is you'd be selling like a 14 vol. Just bear with me here for a second. In a regular ratio back spread, you'd be selling like a 14 or 15 vol. Then you'd be buying a 17 vol, okay? And that's a full 3 points of vol skew against you. So we went out and additionally sold just one unit to offset the vol exposure on these 202s. So it's a nifty little trade over here. It doesn't offset all the vol skew, but what it does is as volatility shifts on you, and the vol skew looks something like that lately, as the vol skew shifts on you, this trade won't change that much because we've actually spread ourselves pretty evenly across that skew. So as it shifts on you, sure, you'll lose a little bit of volatility, but these like 204s, they'll come in a little bit. The 214s have already come in heavily. It'll be minuscule with the vol shift, and that's an important concept. As volatility goes up, you should feel a pump pretty good in all the different strikes across the board on there. So it's a little bit about the risk twist spread, and that's why I wanted to show it, is I think right now better than, you know, pretty much any other time I could think of. I mean, who doesn't want a strategy that can kill it if the markets can tank but not take a lot of risk if we happen to rally, right? That's the idea. Theoretically, you could even be doing this for credit or even money, but you're going to take more risk. You're going to take more risk in the in that kind of valley of death over there. The reason I did it for a 90-cent debit is simply because I had to keep our risk under $1,000 per unit. Why did I have to do that? Because we're going to have everyday retail clients trading this stuff. You know, I'm going to have somebody that has almost no experience trading options putting on one of these spreads. I had to keep their risk contained out there quite a bit. So, all right, so somebody was saying, too good to be true. Where's the risk? Well, the risk is quite simple. The risk is if you fall asleep at the wheel and we come right into here at 205, and you're going to lose $1,000. Can't lose more than $1,000. That's it. You cannot lose more than $1,000. How can you lose $1,000? When I say you fall asleep at the wheel, I'm going to tell you right now, one of the key pieces of criteria of this trade is get the hell out well before expiration. If you're holding this near December expiration, it doesn't matter whether it made money or lost money. If you're holding it anywhere near December expiration, you've done something horribly wrong. And the reality is, I know that this looks like a lot of risk, but if we come down to 205, what will volatility look like? Okay, bear with me. If you come down to 205, volatility is probably going to rally quite a bit. And it's going to ease the pain of this substantially. So, you know, nothing, and I like to make this clear, nothing is ever going to be, if you will, like too good to be true. Of course, there's a risk in it. You know, you just get smarter over time and try to figure out ways to like circumnavigate skew, circumnavigate risk. And, you know, with a strategy like this, if you're using it as a hedge, you hope to never have to use it. If you're using it like me, you hope the world comes apart. You know, hopefully the world falls apart at the seams. Listen, if the world's going to fall apart, I might as well profit from it. That's the way I see it. People don't necessarily like when I say stuff like that, but if it's going to come apart, the hell with it. Hopefully I make a couple of grand that day. And I'm positioned for it right now, being short 6,000 spider deltas, but you got to take a little risk from time to time in the marketplace. But I wanted that strategy to work if all hell breaks loose in markets. And as of right now, it's pretty good. So, Let's read a couple questions. Should also change the date. The Sea of Death won't look too sexy. So, you know, with changing the date forward, let me show you exactly this. So day stepping does that. Okay. What day stepping is basically doing, and I want you to look at this because I know you guys know your risk graphs over here. Here's the Valley of Death. Okay. Right there is the Valley of Death. Well, guess what? That's already moving the date forward. See, people play with this date box down here. Forget this date box. You don't need to move that date box. Just do what? Day step. Day step, and I have 20 days in between. So right here indicates what? November 26th. I told you there's going to be a window to exit this trade. So all hell breaks loose, and what are you going to lose? Come down here, you're going to lose about $350. But need I remind you, if you think you're going to lose $350 here, you're actually wrong. Because volatility will likely come up at least 10 points with the market. Okay, and even if it doesn't come up huge, you know, it's still going to be a negligible loss. You know, even if volatility only moves by 5 points. Because I've seen this. I've actually seen markets tank and volatility not go up. So let's say volatility only goes up by 5 points. Let's be pessimistic in here. Okay, what are you going to lose? About $250. That's it. So the risk is not too extreme in the valley of death over there. So So day stepping, by the way, is day stepping is the way to go. You know, just what it basically does is instead of pushing the date forward day by day, which is cheesy. You know, you can see how the trade matures by doing it, but it's cheesy. You just day step it. And when you day step it, what it does is it looks at, you know, what? 4 to 5 independent time periods. Well, it's 4 independent time periods plus today, which is 5 independent time periods. And as you drag your little mouse, it shows you P&L. Now remember, the analyze tab, okay, it's all theoretical. It's all theoretical. It's all part of it. But the reality of the analyze tab, it's a pretty good indication of when crap hits the fan, what it's going to look like. I mean, the theory is you selecting different parameters. You know, and I'm not really playing around with parameters. I'm letting you guys kind of dictate in here what those parameters happen to be. But yeah, if you're worried about the market tanking, I guess it's a, you know, a pretty good strategy. And for me, I'm worried about it tanking. I'm actually probably right now more worried about it exploding to the upside because we are clearly and decisively right now in a binary marketplace. Like, I mean, I know that I can show you all the risk in the world, but right here, right now, make no two ways about it. This is a binary move. This next move, the thing you've got going for you in the markets right now, every day that we sit in this 2060, you know, 2160, 2180 range, every day that we sit here, the risk ball amplifies. That basically means, I don't know if you guys look at this stuff on a day-to-day basis, approximately 15 million contracts a day are trading in options. That includes index options and all your equity options. 15 million contracts a day have been accumulating since roughly mid-July. Okay, some of those come off, some of them get put back on, but 15 million option contracts a day and tens of millions of futures contracts, the entire professional trading world has risk from 2160 to 2180. So if you haven't noticed this, you're missing out, but every time we break above, like a little bit above 2180, volume starts to spike out there. Every time we break below 2160, volume starts to spike. The whole professional trading world is hedged between 2160 and 2180. When we start to crack those ranges, it's going to get extreme. So I think that my best guess estimate of what happens, we're going to explode to the upside, followed by a violent move down. That would be my best guess, and it is just that. Anybody that says they know what's going to happen in this move is insane, because there is legitimately $1 trillion of risk packed in the strike price range of 2160 to 2180 on the, you know, and I'm just referencing the SPOOs, and that correlates to even Apple. I know Apple's got their event right now, okay? Do they have a new phone? Does it have a camera? Right? It has a camera, it has a phone, it has headphones. It's exciting. It's a phone! People get so excited about like the Apple events, but you know, the entire marketplace, you might want to trade individual stocks right now, but everything is meandering with a pretty good correlation. The reason I think we're going to break to the upside, I'll give it to you pretty straight here. If you look at Facebook and a few others, they've already started it. I mean, Facebook has already had a break to the upside, fell off a little bit today. Google started breaking to the upside over here. So it might be, this might be one last hurrah. You may have already seen that blow off kind of top. Amazon, all-time highs, okay, yesterday, today, it's at an all-time high right this second. So you have a few underlyings that are marching to the upside. Again, it's going to be pretty interesting. I think that the range is done with this week. So here we are on Wednesday. This is it, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. But I think that this range is going to be done with this week. It doesn't mean I think that the market's going to collapse in the next couple of days. That'd be insane. But I think the S&P range is all but done. It's tough at this point to stay inside this range. You've got a lot of traders that are in high-frequency mode. They rely on the S&P's moving and historical volatility. It's never been this low. I don't know, again, what you guys look at on a day-to-day basis, but if you go to something like the spiders, and if you're into realized volatility, come over here to add study, volatility studies, come up to historical volatility. Come on, Thinkorswim. Come on, Thinkorswim. You can do it. Here's historical volatility. It's roughly, what, about 4.8%. Never been lower. I mean, you can look back. I don't care how long you want to look back, right? You want to go back. You got to look on a daily. So I'm actually looking on daily. But do you want to go back since the inception of this product? You are pretty much at the bottom of the realized movement. So the actual price movement in the SPX, spiders, and every S&P product has never been lower than it is right here today. So if I can, if I will, I'm going to go out on a limb and say, pretty sure we're going to start moving. I think it's a pretty safe bet to say, because zero is not a number that's reasonable. But 4%, this actually implies a 0.28% move on a day-to-day basis. So basically it's saying that the S&Ps and the spiders, they're not pricing in less than but like a 0.3% move on a day-to-day basis. That's how low realized volatility is right now. It's not a glorious time to be trading on an intraday basis, but there's still opportunities. I've been scalping bonds on a day-to-day basis. It's kind of crazy, but hey, you know, it does it for me. Wherever I can make a couple of bucks, I'll do just that. And I scalp all day, every day. Do you hedge for a major upside move? So, you know, David, I could use the risk twist spread to the upside. The irony is it would probably work out even better to the upside, but the upside move is not going to be as spectacular. I'm not going to get a $20 move to the upside. And frankly, I find the moves to the upside to be easier to deal with. So I'm short 6,000 spider deltas. And what that roughly means is if the spiders go up a buck, I'm going to lose about $6,000. All right, you know, not going to throw up and cry in my soup over there. If we go up 10 bucks, you know, I'm not going to be happy. That's 60,000 bucks I'm going to lose. But that's, you know, acceptable risk to me. And, you know, you guys got to decide what risk is right for you at any given point in time. And a big portion of that is, again, knowing your comfort level. That's why, like, there's three main principles that we use. Every trader, no matter if they're into charts or not, you know, every trader that works with me here at TheoTrade, they look at their trade logic first. And I don't care if they have the greatest setup in the world, you know, on the chart. They don't put trade logic first. They don't allocate capital. Trade logic means the right strategy, the right implementation. The second thing they're always going to look at is the allocation. All right. You have to know what your allocation is. But I got to tell you, you got to trade without hesitation, reservation, or fear. If you're scared putting on a trade, the market's already got you. You know, you got to trade with you know, utter, you know, again, complacency in the markets doesn't necessarily matter. I'm short 6,000 deltas. If I was scared of the market exploding in my face, I wouldn't be short 6,000 deltas to begin with. I might not be happy if we go up, but it's a reasonable thing. I mean, I look at the market from a risk standpoint. I go about 30 days out. Here, 30 days out, and I look at the expected move. It's about $6. And I take that and I double it. So a $12 move could happen easily in the next 30 days. Does that make me want to throw up? No. $60,000, $70,000, $80,000. What's 80 grand amongst friends? I've been doing it long enough. And again, this is not like, you know, some corporate account or anything. It's just my personal account. It says TheoTrade because I labeled it the TheoTrade account. But it's my capital. So I usually keep about 300 grand in a portfolio margin account. This is portfolio margin. So you'll see the geek fest of margin requirements. Yes, I have a lot of positions on. I mean, Tom, Jim have been great. I've actually known Jim since we were just talking about this. He said he met me in 2002. 2002 is when I was still young and under warranty, you know.
So we were both a lot younger.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm 40 now, man. Can you believe that? I think when I met you, I was, what, again, I got out of school in 98, started trading. I was 22. So I was a ripe old age of like 25, 26, I think, when I met you.
Yeah, yeah.
It's been a long run, a very long run. Anyway, fire away. You got a couple of questions, a couple of comments over here?
Well, I think you answered them as you went, Don, and we're a little over an hour, so it's probably a good time to wrap it up. What do you think?
Good. Good deal. Yeah. I got to get ready for another class that I'm going to be doing today on, you know, obviously tonight. And TheoTrade, the guys are on right now. Again, Jeff Bierman's cruising right now, talking about Ichimoku. Oh, my favorite, you know, my favorite study over there. You guys are not so much into technicals, are you?
I've used them in the past when I did some futures trading. So I'm familiar, but most of the people in our community don't really get into technicals that detailed.
It's my kind of community.
All right, Don. Well, let's call it a day then. Thanks for the presentation. Really appreciate it. I'm sure it'll go well tonight.
All right. Thanks a lot, guys, and I appreciate it.
All right. Thanks,
Don,
everyone.
Thank you so much. We really appreciate you coming on and speaking to our guys. The other thing we really appreciate is you offering us a greater discount than you do to your own clientele there. We really appreciate it. I value our relationship, and thank you sincerely.
Yeah. Thanks, guys. Thanks again.
All right. Thanks, everyone.